Another category, or the third category under the morphological and the physiological, morphological and the anatomical evidences is vestigial organ. So, what are vestigial organs? The vestigial organs are those organs which are no longer in use. जो हमारी बॉडी में प्रेजेंट होने के बाद भी कोई फंक्शन परफॉर्म नहीं कर रहे हैं, दैट आर रिड्यूस्ड टू दैट एक्सटेंट दैट दे आर नॉट एबल टू परफॉर्म एनी फंक्शन, वो इस तरह से या इतना छोटा हो गए हैं या इतने रिड्यूस हो गए हैं कि वो कोई फंक्शन परफॉर्म नहीं कर सकते हैं. दे आर नॉट एबल टू परफॉर्म एनी फंक्शन, देयरफॉर दैट काइंड ऑफ ऑर्गन्स आर कॉल्ड एज वेस्टिजियल ऑर्गन. अब अगर वो वेस्ट वेस्टिजियल ही है, कोई फंक्शन ही परफॉर्म नहीं कर पा रहे हैं, तो वो हमारी बॉडी में कैसे आए? सो दीज ऑर्गन्स और दीज वेस्टिजियल ऑर्गन्स वर समवेयर और सम टाइम फंक्शनल इन अवर एंसेस्टर्स. वो हमारे एंसेस्टर्स में तो फंक्शनल थे ही. Why? Because our ancestors were not having such habitat or were not having this much availability और उनके पास में इतनी सुविधाएं नहीं थी कि वो हमारे जैसे रह सकें. तो in their body there have been developed certain organs so that they can live properly, वो अच्छे से रह सके. दैट्स वाई इन देयर बॉडी दे हैव डेवलप्ड सम स्पेसिफिक टाइप ऑफ ऑर्गन्स विच वर वेरी हेल्पफुल इन देयर बॉडी. बट ड्यू टू द इवोल्यूशनरी कोर्स, जैसे जैसे इवोल्यूशन होता गया, जैसे जैसे एज द टाइम पासिस वी वर बीइंग इवॉल्व्ड, हम इवोल्यूशन हुआ एंड वी इवॉल्व्ड एंड वी बिकम द मॉडर्न मैन. We were having the facilities or we were having the more and more availability of the things which are which we need. So, to unke paas when they were living, they were having the another type of environment. So they were having the specific type of organs, and where we are living, we are having that specific type of organs. But their organs which are developed in our ancestors that are not perished or who that are not extincted, but they that are being passed from the one generation to the another generation and that are being preserved in our body. Wo ek generation se dusre generation mein aake preserve hote ja rahe hain. So these kind of organs are called as vestigial organs. So the term vestigial organ or the scientist who have worked on the vestigial organ, his name is Wider Shane. Wider Shane is the scientist who have worked on the vestigial organ. He told that there are around 100 vestigial organs. 100 vestigial organs are present in human body. So vestigial organ human body mein present hai. So let us take some examples of the vestigial organ. The first example is peninculus carnosus, also called as nictitating membrane. Peninculus carnosus or also called as nictitating membrane. So this nictitating membrane is present in our eyes. If we have observed the structure of the eye, so this so here in this part, the pink colored thing, when we see in our eyes the pink color thing in this corner, the pink color thing, this is the reduced form of the nictitating membrane in our eyes. And this nictitating membrane are present in aquatic animals like in fishes and in tadpoles. This nictitating membrane are functional in the aquatic animals like fishes and the tadpole. So, unme kya hota hai? When these organisms are in the water, to jab wo pani mein rehte hai, then this nictitating membrane cover their eye like this. Nictitating membrane unki aankh ko is tarah se cover kar leti hai, and that is transparent, so that the vision is the clear for that animal. Transparent hoti hai taki wo animal ab achhi tarah se dekh sake. So this is the nictitating membrane. This is the third membrane for protecting our eye. We have two eyelids, upper eyelid and lower eyelid, and it is the third membrane, and it is highly reduced in our in the human beings. The second example is auricular muscles, or the external ear muscles, or ear pinna. Our ear pinna, or the external external ear muscles, or the auricular muscles. These auricular muscles are highly developed in cats and dogs. These are highly developed in cats and dogs. So these animals, cats and dogs, they move their auricular muscles in the direction of this sound. They don't have the capability to turn off their neck, to turn off their, they don't have the such flexible type of neck. So they used to move their auricular muscles in the direction of the sound. Whenever they are in danger, so they used to move their auricular muscles ki kahan se ye awaaz aa raha hai, to so that they can escape anyhow. These are highly developed in the cats and dogs, but they are present in our body, but they are not functional. They are reduced because we are not in the need of auricular muscles. We have a flexible neck and we can also escape from the any kind of danger. So the second example, auricular muscles. The third example, wisdom tooth, or the third molar. The wisdom tooth or the third molar, they generally appears in the later stages, around 20 to 25 years. They generally appears between 20 to 25 years, but they are vestigial. These were used in our ancestors, because our ancestors used to eat the raw food material. So they were having the more work of chewing their food. Unhein apne food ko zyada chew karna padta tha. That's why they have developed the third molar. But we are eating the food which is not, we are not eating the raw food material directly from the animal or directly from the plants. So this third molar is extincted, or the third molar has been reduced in our body, and it is considered as the vestigial organ in our body. The fourth example is a vermiform appendix. The vermiform appendix, or generally we called it as appendix, it is the reduced form ऑफ सीकम, इट इज द रिड्यूस्ड फॉर्म ऑफ द सीकम. सो हमारे एंसेस्टर्स दे यूज टू ईट द फूड डायरेक्टली फ्रॉम द प्लांट्स. सो इन द लीव्स देयर वर द सेल्यूलोस, तो उनके बॉडी में सीकम दैट वॉज हाईली डेवलप्ड फॉर द डाइजेशन ऑफ द सेल्यूलोस. सेल्यूलोस को डाइजेस्ट करने के लिए देवर हैविंग द डेवलप्ड हाईली डेवलप्ड फॉर्म ऑफ द सीकम इन देयर स्मॉल इंटेस्टाइन. बट नाउ वी आर नॉट ईटिंग दैट प्लांट्स और वी आर नॉट टोटली हर्बीवरस एनिमल्स. वी डोंट रिलाय अपॉन द लीव्स ऑफ द प्लांट्स फॉर अवर एज अ फूड मटेरियल. वी हैव चेंज्ड अवर फीडिंग हैबिट्स. So, therefore, the vermiform appendix, which is the reduced form of cecum, has been considered as the vestigial organ in our body. The next example, mammary gland. In males, mammary gland in males, these are vestigial organs. And clitoris in female, clitoris in female, these are also vestigial organs. And the skin moving muscle in cattle. The skin moving muscle in cattle, it is also vestigial. If we have observed in the cows and in the buffaloes that agar un par koi bhi insect agar baithta hai, if any insect is irritating them, they used to only move that part of the skin, wo sir utna hi part ko move karte hai jo part unka affected hai. The part which is being affected or which is being irritated by the particular kind of insect, they only move that part of skin and another the whole body remains the stagnant, remains did not change its position. So this skin moving muscles, which are very much functional in the cattle, but these skin moving muscles are also present in human beings, but they are highly reduced. Now they are of no use, therefore this skin moving muscles are also considered as the vestigial organ in the human body. Now let us discuss some more examples from other animals. In other animals, like in snakes, when we talk about the snakes, the pelvic girdle and femur. The pelvic girdle and femur are considered as the vestigial organs in the snake. Only some traces or the reduced form of this pelvic girdle and the femur are present in the snake. So, the presence of the reduced form of the pelvic girdle and the femur in the pythons or in the boas shows that their ancestors were limbed. Unke ancestors ke paas mein they were limbed. Unke paas limbs present the. So this shows that this shows the evidence of the evolution. That evolution hone ke ancestors of the python were limbed, and after having some type of changes or having developed from the course of evolution, they become limbless, and only the traces of the pelvic girdle and the femur. Pelvic girdle is the lower portion of our body which helps in the articulation of our hind limb bones. The femur, which is the strongest bone of our body or longest bone of our body. So these, the traces of the only femur and the pelvic girdle are present in the python or in the boas. The next, flightless birds. When we talk about the flightless birds, the first example come under our mind is about ostrich. Ostrich is the animal, ostrich is a bird who cannot fly. Though there are wings present in the ostrich, unme wings present hote hai, but the short wings are present that are not fully developed so that they can fly. Wings to present hai, but they are not fully developed. Wo puri tarah se developed nahi hai ki ye birds fly kar sake ya ud sake. Some more examples are dodo, kiwi. And here the dodo is present in Mauritius, was present in Mauritius, and now it is extincted. These are some flightless birds. And the splint bones in horse, the splint bones in horse like this. So this is one finger, or we can call this one toe, and these are the splint bones which are of no use. Only one, or only the single finger, that is the third bone, is highly developed in the horse, and first, second, fourth and fifth, these are now changed into the splint bones by the evolution, by evolutionary changes. All these bones are changed, or all these bones are extincted, or they are considered as vestigial because they are highly reduced, and only the single bone, the third bone, is being functional in horse. About this we will study in the evolutionary history or the of the horse in the next category of the evidences of the evolution. So this is all about the vestigial organs, which was the third category of morphological and anatomical evidences. The fourth category which we are going to talk about is atavism, or the reversion of the organs. The fourth category is atavism or organ reversion. What is atavism or organ reversion? The organs which are extincted or which are considered as vestigial organs, jo ab in the today's man or in the today's generation, the organs which are not present, but in the rarest of the rare case, wo koi bhi newborn baby mein ya newborn offspring mein agar wo present hota hai, that condition is called as atavism. Organs which develop suddenly as they were developed in their ancestors, जो suddenly develop हो जाते हैं in newborns, suddenly develop in the newborns as they were developed in their ancestors, जो पहले तो present है पर अब due to the evolutionary course they are not being present in the today's generation. But suddenly, कभी कभी क्या होता है कि वो organs due to some genetic changes they appears in the newborn baby. So this type of reversion is called as atavism or the organ reversion. We have observed all we have observed that some new bones are took bone with a tail. So the presence of tail in newborn baby, presence of tail in the newborn baby is an example of atavism, because tail were only present in the monkeys and they were also not present in the apes and in the chimpanzees. From that apes and chimpanzees, the tail was reduced to the coccyx bone or the coccyx vertebrae, which is the last vertebrae in our vertebral column. So they are, this tail bone is reduced to the coccyx vertebrae. But sometimes due to some changes or due to some genetic changes, the tail appears in the newborn baby. This is the example of atavism. And the presence of hairs, or sometimes we have observed that some newborn baby are took birth with a thick layer of fur over their body. Unki puri body baalon se ghiri hui rehti hai, ya unki puri body par hairs ka ek thick layer jama hua rehta hai. We have read in news that lion boy of Russia. ऐसा एक example है, in the Russia, one baby took birth with a thick layer of fur over his body and he was named as the lion boy of Russia. So, a presence of thick layer of hairs in newborn baby, this is also the example of atavism. The third we have studied in the vestigial organs, the presence of auricular muscles. As I told you earlier that auricular muscles are functional in animals like cat and dog, they are not being functional in our body. But some human beings are there, kuch aise antique ya exceptional cases hai human beings mein, that who are capable of movement of their ear pinna towards the direction of the sound. So this is the fourth category of the morphological and anatomical evidences.